Good morning and welcome to the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee in Edinburgh here in the Scottish Parliament. So at our last meeting, agenda item one, we agreed to take a decision on private at a future meeting. And as colleagues will recall, we are expecting to have a paper shortly on just our policy with regard to receiving submissions once a petition is actively under consideration. I'd like to suggest that we publish that paper, but that the item is as normal, otherwise conducted in private. Are we content with that?
Yeah.
We are. That's fine. So we move on to item number two, which is the consideration of continued petitions. I should start by offering apologies for two of our colleagues this morning. David Torrance, the deputy convener, and Fergus Ewing are both unwell and not able to be with us. And unfortunately, the SNP substitute is not available to be with us either. So just three of us considering the petitions this morning, but obviously they've received the papers and have had an opportunity to contribute any thinking that they might have to our deliberations. Our first continued petition is petition number 1856, support the taxi trade. And this was lodged by Pat Rafferty on behalf of Unite, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to protect the future of the taxi trade by providing financial support to taxi drivers, setting up national stakeholder group with trade union driver representatives, reviewing low emission standards and implementation dates. And it's some time, but since our last consideration of this petition, we've received a written submission from Transport Scotland in response to our question about the synchronising the rollout of LEZs across Scotland, which the taxi drivers were particularly concerned about. The submission states that local authorities are responsible for deciding the timing for introduction and enforcement. It states that LEZ enforcement began in Glasgow City Centre on June the 1st, as I think is well known by the public now, but that the council has introduced a grace period of 1 year for all and 2 years for residents within the zone. The council has also developed a mechanism for taxi operators to apply for a temporary exemption beyond the June 23 enforcement date. In consequence, Transport Scotland is not minded to mandate a transition to electric vehicles at one point in time as an alternative to offering support with retrofitting. And its view is that it's for operators to decide how to meet the LEZ standards. According to the submission, 250 taxis have now been retrofitted as a result of government funding. And it also states that there are no plans to adapt LEZs beyond the current size and scope or to introduce new LEZs in other parts of Scotland. In consequence, do members have any suggestions on how we might proceed? Mr. Chowdhury.
Yeah, do you think we could write to Transport Scotland, having a department to recognise taxi a form of public transport? Because I don't think we are considering them as a public transport and not giving them to speak.
Well, I mean, I think we have put the petition in touch with Transport Scotland, but I think it would be useful to follow up because we want, I think, to support the petitioner in that objective, because it did seem that they were the one kind of area of public transport that was excluded formally from the process. So we're interested to know how we could try asking how those conversations have gone or whether they've gone at all yet and what the outcome of that is. Could you do that? I think we might also write to the Glasgow Taxi as well, through the petitioner, in fact. Now that the LEZ has been in running since June, we could maybe write asking what the impact of it has proved to be in practice. I think that would be useful to know. We're content. Any other suggestions? No, but I just put that bit of paper wasn't kind of telling me anything I needed to know. No. Okay.
Convener, I think it's also important to hear from Glasgow City Council, as Transport Scotland have referenced them significantly, regarding how many applications have been received from taxi operators for a temporary exemption, and how many exemptions have then been granted, and what criteria there are for receiving a temporary exemption to the LEZ, and how long such exemptions will last.
I'm happy to include that as well, so we can...
How long it will take the taxi drivers to get in touch with the council, because I think, so to get into the council, then they have to go back to get their MOTs and other things done. So it could end up with 2-3 months. So if the exemption is only for a year, they've already lost 3 months.
Fair point. OK. So we're content with the, and we will follow the petition up, keep the petition open, and we will take it forward with that for those further lines of inquiry. Petition number 1919, which is to prohibit the sale of high caffeine products to children for performance enhancement. This has been lodged by Ted Gourley, and it calls on the Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to ban the sale of fast-release caffeine gum to under-18s for performance enhancement due to serious risk of serious harm. We last considered this on the 22nd of February, and we agreed to write to the Scottish Government and UK Athletics. The Scottish Government responded in April, saying that it did intend to publish its analysis of the consultation on ending the sale of energy drinks to children and young people before the summer, which it duly did in May, at which point the Minister confirmed the Government would not be taking forward mandatory measures in this area. The Government also states it will consider commissioning further research into the effects of fast-release caffeine products on children and young people, but this would be part of its wider considerations of public health research. In the first of three submissions to the committee, the petitioners welcomed that news and drawn our attention to a study which concluded that caffeinated chewing gum acutely increases central arterial stiffness and aortic blood pressure in young healthy men. The UK Athletics response notes that caffeine, while not a prohibited substance, is on the World Anti-Doping Agency's monitoring programme, which includes substances they wish to monitor to identify potential patterns of misuse in sport. UK Athletics advocate a food-first approach to nutrition and recommends that if an athlete decides to take a supplement, they only use products which have been tested as part of the Informed Sport Risk Reduction programme. And the petitioners responded to this information, concerned that a consistent approach is not being taken to child safeguarding and protection on the use of stimulants, particularly where fast-release caffeine gum has been handed out at licensed events. The petitioners also raised concerns about how incidents involving the use of fast-release caffeine gum are recorded and reported by athletics bodies. So still all rather uncomfortable background information I think we have here. Do members have any comments or suggestions?
Can we ask for a timescale on this? Because if the government is going to be releasing something, if there is a timeline for this.
I think we could write to the government drawing to their attention the submissions of the petitioner in relation to the ongoing concerns that there are with the fast-release caffeine gum, and therefore ask the Scottish Government when in their public health considerations they think they might consider this, given that it is obviously an ongoing issue and that the UK Athletics body is also concerned and is monitoring these matters as well. Something along those lines? Yeah? Thank you. The third petition is petition number 1966, which is to formally recognise and incorporate local knowledge in Scottish Government policy. And this was lodged by the Scottish Gamekeepers Association. And it called on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to formally recognise local knowledge and ensure it's given full consideration alongside scientific knowledge throughout consultation decision-making processes and in policy development, specifically within the conservation area. Members will recall that we were curious as to whether Nature Scott would appoint a representative from the Scottish Gamekeepers Association to its board. Nature Scott's recent submission explains that members are appointed by Scottish ministers through a regulated public appointments process, and that members are appointed individually and as not as representatives of organisations. The Scottish Government's submission outlines its approach to consultations, saying that consultations seeking public opinion may prioritise local knowledge, while those specifically requesting scientific evidence will be assessed based on their scientific validity. Now, in response to this point, the petitioner feels that scientific knowledge is recognised for its merits, while local knowledge is given no greater credence than that of public opinion. On issues of internet connectivity, the Scottish Government points to alternative methods of gathering evidence such as face-to-face events and notes that only basic internet access is required in order to use its consultation platform. Again, the petitioner argues that the importance of local knowledge is recognised by the Convention on Biodiversity and points to Nature Scott research on indirect drivers of biodiversity loss, according to which local and experimental knowledge tends to be undervalued in decision-making and should be included in governance structures. So I feel a bit of a stalemate, really, in terms of the responses we've received so far. Comments or suggestions from members? In the absence of which, I mean, I do think we could write to the Scottish Government to ask, you know, given everything the petitioner has himself said, you know, whether it will revise its or consider revising its consultation guidance to ensure that it is consistent with the Convention on Biodiversity, at the very least. Anything else we might suggest?
Is it worth following up with Nature Scot as well, in light of its recent report on indirect drivers of biodiversity loss and what action it tends to take on recommendations pertaining to local knowledge?
Yep, I think that would be useful. And I think we might also ask the Scottish Government, if it is the case that that all members of the Nature Scot board are appointed through a public appointments process, what weight they give to local knowledge in the determination of any appointment they make, or whether in fact that really doesn't count, and therefore the petitioner's underlying concern about the absence of it may have some validity. Okay, we'll keep the petition open and act accordingly. Petition number 1976, which is to backdate council tax discounts for dementia to the date of GP certificate lodged by Derek James Brown. And it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to require council tax discounts to be backdated to the date a person was certified as being severely mentally impaired, where they then go on to qualify for a relevant benefit. Now, the Scottish Government's recent submission acknowledges the differing approaches to the administration of council tax disregard and says that officials are working with COSLA to encourage local authorities to adopt a common approach. Colleagues will remember that really we established that it was really quite different depending on where you lived in Scotland, whether or not you got this benefit redressed. The submission was sent in May and said that COSLA leadership was scheduled to consider the proposal in the coming weeks. According to Alzheimer Scotland, Scottish ministers have the power through secondary legislation to amend or remove the statutory test that requires applicants for council tax discount with severe mental impairment to be eligible for a qualifying state benefit. Alzheimer Scotland considers this requirement is unnecessary and adds unfairness to the application process, particularly for individuals who have dementia. Alzheimer Scotland also wants entitlement to a discount or exemption to be uniform across Scotland and for guidance to be developed to ensure the fair application of the legislation. The petitioner's most recent submission draws attention to his petition to the UK Parliament and a UK government response, which states that councils can apply discretionary council tax discounts or exemptions in circumstances where individuals with a severe mental impairment have not demonstrated entitlement to a qualifying benefit. So there has been a move in this direction in the rest of the UK, and they obviously feel the legislation allows that to take place. So I wonder, therefore, what we might further do, colleagues. Any suggestions?
Did the government look into COSLA's consideration at all? Did we do any correspondence in regards to that?
Well, I think we could write to them asking them what the outcome of any of that was. I think that would be perfectly reasonable. And particularly in relation to this point, anything else we could do?
I think as you made in a previous meeting, convener, I think there's still some way to go on this and we don't have an adequate response. And I think with Alzheimer's Scotland's recent written submission, it's worth following up with the Scottish Government with regard to their intentions to amend or remove the legislative test requiring severely mentally impaired people to be eligible to a qualifying benefit in order to obtain a council tax disregard.
I think that would be reasonable, and I think we could point out that it does appear from the submission that the petitioner has tabled that the UK government have indicated that they've moved in that direction, or if they've not moved in that direction, they've clarified that it is possible for that to happen within the rest of the UK, and therefore, you know, the Scottish Government might want to consider following suit. So we'll keep the petition open and move forward on that basis. Petition number 1977, to require social services to inform biological fathers of concerns about their children, lodged by Helen Duncan, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to amend the law and update the National Guidance for Child Protection to require social services to inform biological fathers of concerns about their children. Now, we previously considered this petition at our meeting on the 18th of January, although it seems fresher in my mind than that. It was obviously the 18th of January, the year's going to end, when we agreed to seek views from a number of stakeholders. And we have now received responses from Shared Parenting Scotland, the Scottish Children's Reporter Administration, The Promise Scotland, and CELSIS, Scotland's Centre for Excellence for Children's Care and Protection. And many of the responses highlight the need for discretion and flexibility in relation to informing parents about welfare concerns, noting that there are some circumstances where an obligation to inform a father risks undermining efforts to protect the safety and well-being of the child or children. Shared Parenting Scotland suggests that there is already an obligation on social work and other agencies to inform both parents of concerns about their children and questioning why this is not happening in practice. According to CELSIS, existing legislation and guidance is sufficient to support best practice, and a more effective way to address the issues raised by this petition would be through improvements to workforce learning, knowledge and skills in this area. In light of that, do members have any comments or suggestions?
I mean, I think we should close the petition under Rule 15.7 of the Standing Orders on the basis that the National Child Protection Guidance in Scotland 2021 sets out general principles on how practitioners should involve children and families in child protection processes. And the written evidence suggests that introducing an automatic requirement to inform biological fathers would remove flexibility and discretion from child welfare process and could have the unintended consequence of putting the child at further risk.
Okay.
To that, yeah, because it could open up a lot of other negative avenues.
So we thank the petitioner for the petition. There does appear to be national protection guidance in place. But thank you for raising the issue with us, and obviously it's open to bring back a petition at a later date if we feel that still isn't being acted upon then. Petition number 1982 to review funding arrangements for higher education to help ensure more funded places are available for Scottish ballet dancers at the Royal Conservatoire of Scotland. And this was raised by Gary Mackay. This petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to review the funding provided to the Royal Conservatoire of Scotland and help enable more places to be made available to Scottish students pursuing ballet at this level. This is funding from the Scottish Government, Scottish taxpayer, to Scottish ballet. The committee has received a response from the Royal Conservatoire of Scotland, which begins by challenging the petitioner's claim that there is a five-person cap on places for Scottish domiciled dancers. The response explains that where the figure 5 appears in data sets, this is because standard rounding methodology has been used, whereby numbers have been rounded to the nearest 5 to avoid identifying individuals. The Conservatoire also challenges the petitioner's view that its process for awarding places discriminates against Scottish applicants, stating that Scottish dancers presenting for audition and who meet the required standard have been offered places. The petitioner's response highlights the subjective nature of auditions as a means of assessment and raises questions about 5 dancers who he says were rejected from the Conservatoire despite being offered places by a number of other dance schools. And I have to say I found some of the responses we received here quite intriguing. Do colleagues have any thoughts on this one?
I think I'm surprised to see it. We've only got 5 from 2009 till 2022. I think we should write to the Scottish Royal Conservatoire to find out the exact figure, how many Scottish students got the funding, and if there is a cap. I know they're saying that there is no cap, but surprisingly, it's only 5 every year. And
I'm not clear on the rationale regarding the rounding to 5 or 10 as to why that is appropriate.
I have to say to the Royal Conservatoire that I thought their response was disappointing. I felt almost as though it was designed on the basis that if we read it, we wouldn't take much more interest in the petition and we would be fobbed off with what, to my mind, is a very generalised and not terribly constructive response. As I say, this is funding, as the petitioner points out, that comes from the Scottish taxpayer and the Scottish Government. I think the response they've given almost, in a way, validates the concerns of the petitioner. And it may well be that in due course we might even take evidence on this petition if we don't get something slightly more satisfactory by way of a written response. And of course make our own recommendations to the Scottish Government in relation to the Royal Conservatoire funding in consequence. So I think we might go back to the Royal Conservatoire if we're content. And even, I mean, I even found their argument odd because presumably since all of the people within any aggregated number are receiving funding, I'm not quite sure what the confidentiality issue actually is because... Yeah. So if everybody's getting it, who are we particularly naming as in consequence? But at the very least, if that is an argument that they wish to maintain because they say they are bound by a kind of protocol, I think it would be perfectly possible for us to write to them asking how many Scottish domiciled students in each of the, I would like to say, the last 5 years aggregated were offered places. I think that would allow sufficient anonymity for us to have a handle on the actual number that were involved and how many then took up the offer in consequence as well, in case there's a variation to there.
Can we also ask that how many applied for the funding as well or to get involved in
I think those three things. How many applied, how many were offered and how many took it up, aggregated in five-year increments. And I think we might highlight to them that we were a bit disappointed with their response and we take the petition very seriously, and it may well be that we would consider taking evidence on it before making recommendations to the government in relation to funding matters. Are we agreed?
Yes.
We are. That concludes item three. It brings us to item four, which is consideration of new petitions. Okay. We're expecting... Paul Sweeney and Mark Ruskell to join us. Oh, Mark's here. Right, are you going to speak long enough for Mr. Sweeney to get here, Mr. Ruskell, do you think? Or should we take another petition first before we run to that one? We'll take another one first. I think Mr. Sweeney wants to speak the next one too, so I will race on and see where I get to. We'll therefore consider petition number 2030, which is to review cultural funding arrangements to enable Scotland to contribute to the... we don't need to do that. Mr. Sweeney, gentlemen, if you'd like to take your seats at the table, we will now move to item four. And before we consider new petitions, can I say to anybody who's lodged a petition and is watching, and to anybody who's just following our proceedings, that before we consider the petition, we do invite the Scottish Government and the Impartial Research Service within the Scottish Parliament, SPICE, to offer comment to colleagues on the committee so that we have that background as we begin the consideration of any new petition. However, our first petition this morning is petition number 2028, which is to extend the concessionary bus travel scheme to include people seeking asylum in Scotland. This has been lodged by Pinar Aksu on behalf of Maryhill Integration Network and Doa Abumar on behalf of the Voices Network. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to extend the Scottish concessionary travel scheme to include all people seeking asylum in Scotland, regardless of age. And in our consideration of this petition this morning, we're joined by our MSP colleagues, Paul Sweeney and Mark Ruskell. Welcome to you both, obviously. I think both of you Mr. Sweeney is a veteran of our proceedings, of course, but I believe Mr. Ruskell's been with us to consider petitions previously as well. Anyhow, warm welcome to you both. The petitioner highlights the challenging financial circumstances asylum seekers face, suggesting that extending the concessionary bus travel scheme would support asylum seekers as a group becoming much more integrated into our communities. As the SPICE briefing notes, people seeking asylum in the United Kingdom are usually ineligible for most welfare benefits. They have to use the term many of us are familiar with, no recourse to public funds. However, the Scottish National Concessionary Travel Schemes are not listed by the UK government as benefits that rely on public funds, meaning that some asylum seekers can already benefit from free bus and coach travel. Scottish Government officials estimate around one-third of people seeking asylum in Scotland are already eligible for concessionary bus travel under the existing schemes. That is, those who are under 22 and over 60 or who are disabled. The Scottish Government response also provides information about a pilot to provide travel support to asylum seekers in Glasgow, which ran from January to July this year. And we've also received a submission from the petitioner drawing our attention to pilots that have taken place in Aberdeen and Falkirk, as well as encouraging the Scottish Government and Transport Scotland to continue engaging constructively on the issues raised by this petition. And before I ask colleagues what thoughts they might have and how we might proceed in relation to this petition, I'll invite both of our colleagues to speak. So, Mr. Ruskell, would you like to offer a contribution?
Well, thanks very much, convener, and for giving me the opportunity to speak to this petition. I mean, this is an issue that I've been aware of for a number of years now. And, you know, talking to people who are in the asylum system, talking about the daily pressures that they face, the poverty that they have to endure, the lack of opportunity, the constriction on their everyday lives. It just feels like this is the minimum that we can do to support them. I mean, the committee will be aware that the amount of money that asylum seekers have to live on is very low. I think it's around £5 a day. I think if people are living in hotel accommodation, it's around £1 a day. So I can't imagine how hard that would be to live on that amount of money. It feels to me like an absolute impossibility. The other side of this is that I've seen just how transformative the under-22s concessionary travel has been for young people, how it's opened up opportunities, how it's really helped people to build relationships, to save money, to access jobs, employment, and just to go about their everyday lives and to have that kind of freedom. Now, I know that, you know, a lot of those freedoms people in the asylum system don't have as a right, but you know, the basic freedoms, just to get about, to participate in society, to see their friends, to see you know, colleagues and others, and to engage with the community, is hugely restricted. So just having free bus travel, I think, would make a massive difference. And the evaluations that you pointed to for the very limited pilots that have happened already, I think in Aberdeen and Wales. We're still waiting, I think, for the pilot from Glasgow. I think we'll show what the value of this policy is. And it feels to me like it would be a natural extension to the government's existing concessionary travel scheme for over 60s, under 22s and people with disability to just include this category of people within that. I have to say that I'm really at a loss as to why this hasn't already been introduced. I really am, because I think the information you've had through the SPICE briefing is quite clear. This isn't included in that category of benefits that are not eligible for people with no recourse to public funds. So it really does beg the question, you know, is there another reason here? Is there another legal interpretation that the government has, which is making them cautious? Are there complexities with extending the existing card-based concessionary travel scheme to people in the asylum system? Are there issues about identification or other issues around budget? I genuinely don't know, and I don't think we've had clear answer from recent transport ministers. And I would say that we've had four transport ministers in the last 2 years, so there's a question there as well. But I am concerned this is an issue which is falling between different ministerial responsibilities. I am concerned that we don't have a clear view from government as to reason why this can't be introduced. But I think the case for it remains, and I think it would be a great service for this committee to sort of get under the bonnet of this issue and understand, you know, why this hasn't been introduced. Because on the face of it, you know, this is in line with the kind of environment that Scottish Government are trying to create here, a welcoming environment for people in the asylum system as their claims are being processed. I just don't understand why this hasn't been extended right now. And at the end of the day, we're talking about small numbers of people, I think less than 6,000. So, again, I don't understand if there's a budget reason here. I don't understand the reasons why, you know, this support hasn't been extended already. So,
thank you very much for that. I know you're not here to give evidence, but I was going to ask a question and you answered it there, which was the numbers of people that might be involved. And I think you've quantified that there at around about 6,000 or thereby. And I suppose the other potential reason which you didn't volunteer is it possible that this request has been blended in with other requests for extension to the scheme and therefore, rather than move on any, they move on none sort of thing, given that it might then be used as a kind of basis for an argument in another area of extension, which I don't... I mean, I'm not arguing that that would be the right thing to do, but I just wonder if maybe that also is in the minds of people who have maybe not taken this issue forward.
I think that's an excellent point, Convener, because the way that the concessionary travel scheme has been established and, you know, the evidence test for extensions of that concessionary travel scheme, you know, there are certain conditions around that. There are certain, you know, qualities of evidence that need to be submitted. So I think that would get into the guts of the reasons why this hasn't been extended up to now. And I do understand that government is currently engaged in a fair fares review. So they're looking at, you know, concessionary travel and fares across all public transport. And I understand the Transport Minister gave evidence to the NZ Committee this week that will be concluding, I think, next year. So clearly, you know, there are demands for extension of concessionary travel, people in island communities, people need companions to join them if they've got site issues. Those exist, but I think understanding the context of how government is looking at extension of concessionary travel would be very useful. But zeroing in particular as to why this has taken so long for government to come to a considered view and how this fits with the Fair Fares review, I think would be a good place to go in terms of questioning and scrutiny.
Thank you very much. Mr. Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener. It's a pleasure to be back in the committee and really just here to commend and echo my colleague Mr. Oskell said, this petition to you. The genesis of it really came from discussions with people seeking asylum in Glasgow over a number of years, discussing some of the practical challenges they face living in the city, particularly in the wake of the pandemic. And there was a particularly harrowing anecdote that one of the gentlemen mentioned about having a abscess in his gum and he had to get emergency dental treatment, but he couldn't afford the bus fare into town, so he had to walk 10 miles in the pouring rain to go and get emergency dental treatment in severe pain because of his financial position as an asylum seeker. So you know, that really struck me as quite a shocking scenario in a country like ours, and that kind of moved me to sort of ask them what would practically help make a difference. And that's really where the whole kind of idea of extending the concessionary travel scheme came from. And indeed, that subsequently led to the launch of a campaign in December 2021 in conjunction with the Voices Network and Maryhill Integration Network. The campaign has since attracted widespread support from across the asylum sector and continues to be championed by Thug Sector colleagues, including those from Maryhill Integration Network, the Scottish Refugee Council, Friends of Scottish Settlers, Just Right Scotland, Grampian Regional Equality Council, amongst others. People seeking asylum do not have the right to work. That's the critical issue. And instead rely on a financial allowance from the Home Office to cover the basic costs of living. And this allowance isn't inflation-proofed. It amounts to around £6 per day. And for those living in hotel accommodation, which is an increasing number, it can be as little as £1.36 a day. So effectively, you know, very limited freedom to move and undertake any sort of real life, to be honest. And in Glasgow, the cost of an all-day bus ticket is £5. So that means effectively not just recreational activity or what have you, social activity, but travel to essential medical, social, legal Home Office appointments, often at short notice, is simply not an option for many people. Seeking asylum in Glasgow and elsewhere in Scotland now, unless they forego food or other essentials, which has severe impacts. I've had testimony from mothers caring for young children, for example, who have gone without food to make sure their child gets a basic sort of nutrition because they had to attend a Home Office appointment under threat of deportation. So severe psychological implications there as well. Asylum accommodation, due to the cost pressures, is often situated in isolated peripheral parts of the city. An unaffordable public transport system, often one that doesn't actually function as well, is ultimately compounding that isolation for many people seeking asylum in Scotland today. So free bus travel is one relatively small practical intervention that we could make that would allow people to integrate, explore their new surroundings, their new communities, their new country. And I've been proud to amplify this proposal in partnership with constituents and colleagues in the third sector. I've mentioned previously some of the organisations working with people seeking asylum who have been spearheading this campaign since its launch in 2021. But I think it's important also to reference that this policy has support from across civil society. Indeed, all faith leaders in the Scottish Religious Leaders Forum have signed an open letter in support of the proposal. And it's also been recommended by the Mental Health Foundation and the Poverty Alliance. So from a parliamentary perspective also, it's been fantastic to work with cross-party colleagues such as Mr Ruskell and Mr Doris, the MSP for Glasgow Maryhill and Springburn, to engage with Scottish Government on this ask, including both in writing and meeting with successive transport ministers and indeed with the Transport Scotland Agency. And personally, I've also met with Shona Robinson, MSP, in her previous role as Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Housing and Local Government, and with Neil Gray, MSP, in his previous role as Minister for Culture, Europe and International Development with special responsibility for refugees, both of whom saw personally merit in the proposals and undertook to explore them further. And to that end, the Programme for Government 2022-23, they did commit to work with the third sector partners and councils across Scotland to consider how best to provide free bus travel for people seeking asylum. And since then, a pilot has been run in Glasgow, but there has not been really any further update given or any mention of further work or extrapolation of that pilot in this year's Programme for Government, both of which are extremely disappointing to us, to those of us who have worked on this project for almost 2 years. So on that end, I would encourage colleagues on this committee to keep the petition open and to invite witnesses, those personally seeking asylum who are affected by the implications of that, to speak to the impact of this policy would have on their lives and indeed their current situation, which could potentially inform future correspondence from the committee to the government regarding these proposals and perhaps create greater impetus to move forward with it. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr Sweeney. Did you recognise the 6,000 figure? Did that seem familiar to you?
It does vary, obviously, the level of people in the country at any one time, but broadly around the 6,000 figure. We've done some rough sort of cost estimates. It's very marginal cost to the public, in terms of the wider benefits it would really realise in terms of people's well-being, in terms of social interaction, etc. It's a very small percentage even of the existing concessionary travel scheme in terms of the cost that would run. So quite a marginal increase in the overall provision. I think the government did mention in its correspondence that around a third of people seeking asylum currently would qualify under the existing young persons and disabled or over 60 schemes. So we're really just filling in that gap of people of working age, really.
Thank you very much. I think this is an important petition, and I think it's got quite a specific and deliverable ask in relation to it. Do colleagues have any thoughts, having heard from Mr. Ruskell and Mr. Sweeney?
We keep it open and get third sector organisations involved as well, because a lot of people don't have direct access to Scottish Refugee Council as well. So to get third sector involved, other communities involved, I agree with
specifically both of my colleagues. Might we contact
the smaller organisations? Doesn't have to be like there's like in Edinburgh you have Sembo, you have not Sembo. Sembo's in Glasgow, isn't it? Like third sector organisations.
Mr. Golden,
convener, the starting point might be to write to the Scottish Government to first of all understand both the Scottish Government's assessment of this particular proposal, costs associated, indeed their understanding of the numbers, because I think that's probably important, although we've got estimates today, and ask for an update on the options they're exploring with regard to this specific issue, and thereafter it might be worthwhile considering whether further evidence is required, or indeed whether that be written or in person.
Right, I think we might ask them specifically as well where the pilots have actually managed to get to in terms of outcome. Any other organisations we could write to just in relation to all of this, or do we think that in the first instance we want to hear from them? I mean, I think there's merit in hearing from the Scottish Refugee Council and Scottish Refugee Survival Trust. I'm minded that the Scottish Parliament's conveners group next week will be putting questions to the First Minister directly, and I wonder if this might not be an issue where I, on behalf of the petitioner, could put the question directly to the First Minister. So I think that's something we might consider, because the question session with the First Minister next week is on the programme for government. So I think this, from everything that I've heard, fits in quite nicely with that, and therefore it might be an opportunity to highlight the work of Mr. Sweeney and Mr. Ruskell. Also, the nice thing about the conveners group when you're the convener of the Petitions Committee is you're not raising something on behalf of any political party, you're raising it on behalf of the petitioner. And it will be an opportunity for the petitioner's concern to be put directly to the First Minister. And it seems like something that might be, therefore, give it a little bit of an impetus as well. So we'll keep the petition open, we'll advance and all that. We may take evidence subsequently, but let's see what progress we can make in the first instance. Since there does seem to be, or have been, an area of goodwill, but it does seem from what Mr. Ruskell said is that having got so far, it's then got into a kind of basket of things where nothing actually then makes further progress after that. Mr. Sweeney?
I'd also say that really what we're looking for is an extension under a statutory instrument to the existing concessionary travel scheme. That would be the simplest and neatest solution. And certainly rough and ready cost estimates suggest that it would be around £500,000 per annum. So we're not really talking about a substantial sum of money in the grand scheme of the Scottish Government's fiscal position. I think there's plenty of headroom to deliver this policy. You know, it's been perhaps confused with some of the pilots being done through third sector partners. Maybe the cleanest and neatest solution is to just simply go on with the statutory instrument.
Okay, thank you all very much. I think we're content. Petition number 2029, to nationalise Clyde Port to bring the ports and harbours on the River Clyde into public ownership. This has been lodged by Robert Birds on behalf of the campaign to save Inchgreen Dry Dock. It calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to use powers under the Harbours Act 1964 and the Marine Navigation Act 2013 to revoke the Peel Ports Group Clyde Port Operation Limited's status as the harbour authority for the River Clyde and its estuary, to establish a municipal port authority in Clyde Port's place and bring the strategic network of ports and harbours along the River Clyde into public ownership, and the compulsory purchase Inchgreen Dry Dock for the benefit of the Inverclyde community. In background to this petition, the petitioner raises concerns about ships breaking away from the moorings at Clyde Port managed ports and the future of the Inchgreen Dry Dock at Greenock. Our Spice briefing notes that the Harbours Act 1964 allows Scottish ministers to make an order relieving the Harbour Authority of its statutory powers, but only if the Harbour Authority applies for the order or consents to it being made, or if ministers have consulted with the authority and are satisfied it is unlikely to object. In responding to the petition, the Scottish Government notes that Scottish ports operate in a commercial environment, usually with no direct public funding. The response goes on to argue that the activities Clyde Port facilitates, the employment which it provides for, and the investment made in recent years are of significant importance to the Scottish economy. The Scottish Government states that it has no plans to explore compulsorily purchasing, revoking the powers of, or nationalising Clyde Port. The petitioner has also provided a submission with further details on the campaign's concerns surrounding the regeneration of Inchgreen Dry Dock, as well as concerns about the delays to Ardrossan Harbour project. Now, our MSP colleague Katie Clark had hoped to join us for the consideration of this petition, but is unfortunately unable to do so. She has, however, provided a written submission which details various concerns raised by her constituents about Clydeport's management of ports and harbours along the Ayrshire coast. However, staying with us from the concessionary petition we've just heard, we have Paul Sweeney, MSP, who has an interest in this petition. And so before we have a think about it as a committee and consider comments or options, I'll invite Mr. Sweeney to contribute first.
Well, thanks, Convener. And this is a petition that I have an interest in personally. I have a background in the shipbuilding industry in the Clyde, working for BE Systems. And I've maintained a long-standing interest in the development of the Clyde corridor as an industrial asset for the wider city region. And I have had long-standing concerns about its general long-term decline as a major port. And that really stems from ambitious plans that were launched around 20 years ago to develop Hunterston and Greenock as one of the major transatlantic transshipment terminals for containers coming across the Atlantic. And at that time, there was a huge investment planned in that respect. And then Clydeport PLC merged with or was purchased by Peel Group, which also owns the Mersey Docks and Harbour Company and has a major interest in the Mersey. So another competing west coast of Britain port, and subsequently huge investment on the order of billions of pounds have gone into developing the Liverpool One container terminal in Liverpool. And the focus very much of Peel Group's operations as a port authority have been into the Mersey at the expense of the Clyde. So I think there is a general concern, long-standing, that the Clyde is being in a pattern of managed decline and disinvestment over many years, and that the focus has been very much on the Mersey side, to the extent to which, if you want a pilotage on the River Clyde, you're calling the Mersey, a call centre in the Mersey to get access to the River Clyde. It seems to me the number of fronts unacceptable. And perhaps there are some parallels with the previous inquiries into the management of airports in Scotland, where there was an issue with the one company managing both Glasgow and Edinburgh airports having a conflict of interest in that regard. There has not really been any serious inquiry or study into this and the potential long-term economic effects on the west of Scotland and the greater Glasgow city regions. There is a container terminal in Greenock, of course, but it doesn't even feature in the top 10 British ports anymore. It's been in decline for a long time. At one time, it was the fifth biggest container port in the UK. It no longer appears on any of the top 100 ports in Europe, for example. So there is a major long-term concern. There's a high correlation with the level of freight traffic coming through ports and levels of economic growth. So I think there is a yoke on the west of Scotland's potential. We've seen recently the publication of statistics on population that the west of Scotland is in long-term decline. There is a broader issue here that the government really needs to pay more attention to. We need to have a serious ports policy and a policy for growing freight traffic through Scotland, ship movements, and also the associated industries such as ship repair. And to that end, I think the petitioner makes some serious and valid points. I think we should be guided by measurable outputs. What is the goal to grow the Clyde? What is the goal to develop and invest in the Clyde and its operations? That is not clear at this point in time. There have been stop-start projects associated with the Inchgreen Dry Dock, which is the biggest mainland dry dock in Great Britain. Contrast that with Belfast, where we're seeing massive investment in the former Hall and Wolff shipyard site. Nothing corresponding happening on the Clyde. So a number of fronts have concerns. And even in a more parochial sense, the Upper Clyde effectively isn't dredged anymore beyond the Govan shipyard site and at Brayhead, where the King George V dock sits. And that is a major concern because there's a real dearth of recreational traffic on the Upper Clyde. I think if anyone is familiar with the Clyde side around Glasgow, there aren't many boats going along, in contrast to somewhere like Merseyside, where it's teeming with marinas, wharfage, and lots of recreational craft. If Glasgow, for example, had a marina at the Pacific Quay, it would be a huge boon for the city and generate millions of pounds of revenue. There isn't any attention being applied to this. And it is quite extraordinary, in my view, that a private bill was passed in the early 1990s that effectively gave quasi-legislative control to a private enterprise to effectively manage 450 square miles of riverine land in the west of Scotland with huge legal privileges and bylaws, including the management of the riverbed itself. So the obligations they have in legislation to maintain a navigable channel as far as the tidal wharf at Glasgow Green haven't been adhered to for many years. And that has starved and damaged and stymied the potential of the Clyde from central Glasgow all the way down to the estuary. And I think it does merit a broader inquiry. And I'm not impressed, frankly, with the government's blasé brush-off in its response to this committee and this petition. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Sweeney. I actually hesitate to invite colleagues to consider matters at all because I think your knowledge is fairly comprehensive. Do you have any suggestions as to what the committee might itself consider doing?
This has been raised both in the House of Commons and in the Scottish Parliament over the years, but it's not really had any serious focus, and it's been most frustrating, and I think a number of parliamentarians across parties have expressed this concern. So I think that the creation of a space to look at this in greater depth would be fantastic, and I think the Public Petitions Committee serves, you know, a good opportunity to be that space for this wider consideration. So looking at stakeholders up and down the Clyde, I know colleagues have suggested some stakeholder groups perhaps in the estuary, Firth of Clyde area, but perhaps also looking at submissions from the Greater Glasgow City Region Councils, also looking at perhaps some of the major industrial companies on the Clyde, such as BE Systems, such as Mallin Group, who are looking to develop infrastructure on the Clyde, would be helpful, as well as perhaps Ferguson Marine and other parties who have industrial operations on the Clyde. There might also be worth speaking to Maritime UK and other trade bodies that look at port development, to perhaps get some analysis around the longer term growth of the Clyde as a port relative to other competitor ports in the UK, just to sort of start to establish a bit of a base of evidence as to what is going on. I think it would also be good if Peel Group would respond to some of this. I think it's important that they justify their position and set out their plans for investment and the Clyde. You know, no one's per se against Peel. What we're concerned about is the lack of clear operational ambition for the Clyde as an asset. If they were to rise to that challenge, then I think people would be more relaxed about their stewardship of the river.
Well, I'm very grateful for your experience and passion and obviously range of comprehensive suggestions there. Colleagues, I mean, I'm very happy to embrace all the suggestions Mr. Sweeney has made. Are there any others colleagues might wish to add? Mr. Golden.
I think, first of all, the committee needs to be clear that we're really conflating two separate asks here. One, in relation to what we've heard this morning around the future of the Clyde, and the second part, which I believe is what the petition focuses on, is the change of ownership with regard to the future of the Clyde. And I think we just need to be clear that one doesn't necessarily link to the other, but it could. But our focus really needs to be on the latter point, although I think it would be useful to have a fully informed opinion around the future of the Clyde from interested parties. With that, and particularly with regards to the petition, I think it might be useful to write to the Scottish Government regarding both aspects, future of the Clyde and ownership, and particularly, and I refer to Katie Clark's submission, the former Transport Minister Jenny Gilruth, and I'm reading from it, said she acknowledged that private ownership of harbours can substantially slow progress in relation to improvements. Now, that strikes me, if that is indeed Scottish Government policy, that that would lead one to a conclusion that the petition should be warmly welcomed, if that's the case. But I think it's important to clarify that with the Scottish Government, and I think it's worthwhile, in addition to that, writing to the British Ports Association, UK Chamber of Shipping, CMAL, Calmac Ferries, Inverclyde Council, North Ayrshire Council and Glasgow City Council.
Which I think were some of the suggestions along with others that Mr. Sweeney made. Yes, I mean, I do think that the petition opens up an area about which I myself knew very little, I have to say, and yet, born, raised and lived in and around the city of Glasgow, through which the Clyde is the dominant feature all my life, without really giving any recent thought to the issues that are raised in the petition, or indeed the issues that have been discussed in some detail by Paul Sweeney. And I have, from time to time over the decades, wondered myself about, you know, the lack of any transformative. I mean, I used to come home from school when there were still wharf buildings all the way up right into the city centre along the Clyde and things happening in them, and they were all done away with. And then I think we had river taxis for all of 5 minutes, which didn't really amount to very much. And then I seem to remember there was a flying plane that would go to Oban from somewhere on the river. But compared to other major cities that you visit, where the river is still a teeming lifeline through the city, the Clyde sits rather dormant, really, and apart from city life. And I think some of the issues raised by the petition and by Mr. Sweeney might be underpinning some of the lethargy that is associated with all of that. So very happy to take all these issues forward at this stage, and we'll obviously hear, consider the petition further and decide what we might further want to do when we get the various responses. So thank you very much. That brings us to the petition we very nearly started earlier on and then stopped mid-stride, which is petition number 2030, to review cultural funding arrangements to enable Scotland to contribute to the Venice Biennial in 2024. This has been lodged by Denise Hooper, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to review the funding it provides to Scotland plus Venice, and to ensure the Scottish artists can contribute to the Venice Biennale in 2024. The petitioner notes that Scotland has participated at its own entity in the Venice Biennale since 2003, with people attending the festival specifically to see the Scottish contributions. The Minister for Culture, Europe and International Development has responded to the petition, saying that the decision to pause involvement in the Biennale in 2024 is to allow for an important period of reflection and review. The review was expected to begin during the summer just past and was to include a process of sectoral engagement to explore new approaches to the project for the longer term. The petitioner has also provided a submission highlighting recent comments by the First Minister about the value of culture and urging a greater focus on the benefits of Scottish culture and arts being promoted on such a prestigious international stage. Well, I'm tempted to ask what the important period of reflection and review was about. So I presume it was on wider considerations than just this one contributory event. But do colleagues have any suggestions? I think we could certainly write to the Scottish Government asking for an update on its work to their international culture strategy. I'd be interested to know what this phrase, decision to pause involvement to allow for an important period of reflection and review, actually means. What was important about it, and how long are they reflecting, and what are they reflecting on that is important? Just to know. I think we might also write to Creative Scotland to seek information on the review of the Scotland plus Venice project. Perhaps also I'd be interested to know what the outcomes of our past participation have been. I mean, I don't think that's terribly clear. Just what have we seen, and how does this, maybe Creative Scotland can tell us how that compares to our participation in other events, and it may well be that is what the Scottish Government is reflecting upon. But I think if we heard from all of them, that would be helpful. Anybody else?
I think it'd be useful in addition to that to include what monitoring metrics they currently use to analyse success or otherwise.
I think we should ask for a timeline as well on this.
I thought you were going to suggest we go on a fact-finding visit to Venice, Mr. Chairman.
I was going to say that. That was the next thing, that when are we going there?
OK, well, we're right to all those organisations. Thank very much the petitioner, Denise Hooper, for the petition, and we will be investigating further where this sits. And I think our final petition this morning is petition number 2031, to provide insulin pumps to all children with type 1 diabetes in Scotland. And there is a sense of déjà vu, I think, when I first came onto the Petitions Committee some 12 years ago. One of the first petitions we considered was on the availability at all at that time of insulin pumps. So here we are again with a petition lodged by Maria Aitken on behalf of the Caithness Health Action Team. And it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to ensure that children and young people in Scotland who have type 1 diabetes and would benefit from a life-saving insulin pump are provided with one, no matter where they live. The petitioner highlights what she views as a postcode lottery relating to the provision of continuous glucose monitoring and insulin pumps for children with diabetes, with a particular concern about the waiting lists for these devices across NHS Highland. Responding to the petition, the Scottish Government refers to the Diabetes Improvement Plan, which aims to increase access to existing and emerging diabetes technologies that can significantly benefit people with type 1 diabetes. The Scottish Government response also highlights that between 2016 and 2021, it invested an additional £15 million to support the increased provision of insulin pumps and continuous glucose monitoring. The Government also points to current work to roll out diabetes technology and a particular focus on reducing regional variation. Do members have any comments or suggestions?
Diabetic Scotland to get their view on that. I think... Did you write to the Jenny Minto for any update on that one? The Minister for I can see there is a suggestion where it says that we write to Jenny Minto for further help. For any suggestions?
Yes, I think we might get to that. I might quite like to write to the different health boards to just ask what the current status within each health board is. I mean, the assertion here is that it's a postcode lottery. Yeah. And I have a recollection that right back at the start, when it was the provision of insulin pumps at all, it was a health board lottery issue way back then in terms of the provision, with, I think, Greater Glasgow and Clyde having embraced them and other health boards not way back all that time ago. So I think it would be interesting to know what the provision is within each health board and what policies they have surrounding the award of insulin pumps to children, because this sits within a framework where I think it is the case that they are, you know, children are meant to get them if they need them. So yeah. I think we want to find out where we're actually at with all of that. We could, and Diabetes Scotland and the Insulin Pump Awareness Group might be able to help us in that work as well. I think that would be helpful in the first instance, because I mean these are very, very important matters to those people who in life depend upon them. Thank you. So we'll keep the petition open and we will make those inquiries and consider it afresh when we get responses. That concludes the consideration of our petitions today. We're next due to meet on the 4th of October. And on that note, I therefore formally close the meeting. Thank you all very much.